This is Dennis McMahon, and welcome to Positively Vermont. Today, my special guest is Aly Richards, the CEO of the Permanent Fund for Vermont's Children. Welcome, Aly.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you. And this is a very important issue and a very interesting organization that you're heading. But first, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Sure. I grew up in Vermont, a little town called Newberry. I went to Oxbow High School and actually got my first taste of the political policy world as a high school student. I was the student member on the State Board of Education, appointed by Governor Dean. So that was sort of a very interesting to see how important it is to have internships, opportunities like that, as a young person to really see the world and your place in it and what you might be able to contribute. I went out of state for college, and then I ended up working in Washington, D.C. For a couple of years, still thinking about politics, trying to have the biggest impact I could as a younger person. Ended up working on the first Obama presidential campaign. Mm-hmm. And after he was elected, I was really a little bit disenfranchised by the lack of civil discourse and work happening, productive work happening down at the federal government. So I actually ran home as fast as I could to really make a difference. So I was so pleased to have a place like Vermont to come back to and really be able to work on something that I really feel passionately about. I worked in the governor's office under Governor Shumlin for a few years and did a lot of policy work, mostly ended up turning into an education work as education rose to the top as one of these key fundamental aspects of our state that we need to focus on. And really learned a lot in that role and then transitioned over to run the Permanent Fund about 2.5 years ago.
Great. Well, tell us about the fund. What exactly, tell us about its history. I understand it's very interesting.
Great. So the Permanent Fund for Vermont's Children, it was founded in the year 2000 by some business men and women who decided they wanted to have the greatest possible impact on the future of Vermont, a state that they loved. And so they ended up focusing on early childhood education, and not everybody makes that leap right off the bat. So why, if you care deeply about a sustainable future for the state, is early childhood education your single focus? And it really comes down to this logic model of what we know about the science and the research. The brain science shows you that 80% of a child's brain and the foundation of sort of their future success and resiliency against chronic disease or addictive behaviors, executive function, the ability to sort of manage emotions and handle complex situations is really fully in place by age 3. That's 80% of the foundation, and 90% of the foundation by age 5. So if these are the most crucial years in a child and family's life, where are kids in Vermont? And that's a question that's also true for the whole country. And the truth is, you know, there have been many changes. We don't make any statement whether it makes sense to be in the workforce or not. We just went to the data. And 7 out of 10 kids in Vermont under 6 have all available caretakers or parents in the workforce, which means they're just no longer at home during these crucial years for the most part. And so we'll get into this in a little bit later, I think. But we started looking then at, well, okay, if they're not at home, where are they? And we saw that we almost had a crisis level of the amount of childcare, regulated childcare that was available to this population in need, and then how much of that was actually affordable for families, and how much of that was high quality. And so our mission of high quality, affordable childcare for all who need it in Vermont by 2025 came from that logic model of we really want to have a thriving future for our state of Vermont. And here's a linchpin issue, sort of a root cause issue. So just a little bit more about the history, because it is sort of interesting, and it has been now 18 years. We're a supporting organization of the Vermont Community Foundation. So we are affiliated with them. They're our back office. And we partner with them on many things. And then the founders sort of started by saying, let's just pool sort of lots of different folks that are interested in early childhood who have done philanthropic work in early childhood and target sort of a policy issue that we think we can really move the needle on. So they started experimenting on how to make the biggest impact using philanthropy in early childhood education. And the first way to do it was leveraging each other's resources. So let's pool some funding. We've all been doing this work for, you know, a while in this space, and we haven't moved the needle on quality access or affordability for 0 to 5 high quality early childhood education. So let's see what we can do. So at that time, they pooled, this was in about 2005, when they sort of started experimenting of how to make a really big difference in this area. They pooled resources and created the Vermont Community Preschool Collaborative, which is one of the projects of the Permanent Fund, partnered with the Turrell Fund and Henderson Foundation and other early childhood partners. And they said, okay, well, we want to take the pre-K law that's on the books, and it's voluntary. It's voluntary for a town to offer pre-K. Mm-hmm. And they said, well, it's very hard for a town to start offering pre-K because even though they're allowed to, it's not mandatory, and you don't get funding for it until mm-hmm. the second year. So what this philanthropic group was able to do with some resources and being nimble was say, okay, we're going to go town to town, give startup grants, build relationships, connect the dots, and before you knew it, 20% of communities had been offering pre-K, 80% started offering pre-K because of the work we were doing in communities. And that led to this idea of, for policymakers, well, wait a minute, now it depends where you happen to wake up in the morning if you have access to pre-kindergarten education. That's an equity issue, and we really try to prefer to not do that in Vermont when possible. So that led to a universal pre-K law, which we now have, and Vermont was the first state in the country to have a universal pre-K law for 3- and 4-year-olds with a sustainable funding source. So what does that mean? It means higher quality and more affordable for families in Vermont. So now we have 80% almost of our students. I think actually it's 73% as of the last census who are 3- and 4-year-olds that are eligible for pre-K are actually taking advantage of it.
That's amazing. And the studies show that pre-K really is such a tremendous heads up or an advantage. I was involved in pre-K programs in another state, and we were replicating grants, and we finally established one, and just the benefits of it were amazing.
Absolutely, and that's something that's interesting. A lot of people approach this work from different angles. Some just see that this is sort of almost a moral imperative. This is what kids and families need. And some say, well, you know what? There's also a cold, hard capitalist case for this too. It's one of the best return on investments you can possibly get, as you're saying, Dennis. You know, it's this idea of if you help kids and families between in this crucial age of their development, 0 to 5, you know, you save down the road on healthcare costs, you save on even substance abuse, you can save on special education and other areas. So it sort of depressurizes costs down the road. So we actually worked with the Vermont Business Roundtable a couple years ago and did a return on investment study. And we showed that in Vermont, if you actually made the investment to create a system of high quality, affordable early childhood education, 0 to 5, it would be a sort of 1 to 3 return on investment, just the tip of the iceberg with the data we had available to us, which is pretty good as return on investments go.
We have a very, very good website, which really explains all the problems. In fact, there's some alarming statistics shown there, the way they grow, the 70, 80, 90%.
That's right.
What if you could explain that again?
Absolutely. So one of the first things that we did when we decided our mission is high quality, affordable, early care and learning for all by 2025. That's one other thing I wanted to mention earlier, actually, your question of the history of the Permanent Fund. We've given ourselves a deadline of 2025. And I can tell you, you know, running this organization, nothing holds people's feet to the fire, my own included, like a deadline. Mm-hmm. So we've created that urgency for ourselves and a very focused mission with a very focused deadline. And we're marching forward sort of to that date. And we actually will go away. The Permanent Fund will go away in 2025. A little funny,
it
right?
Like
with the Permanent Fund. So, and it's, I almost like that because it makes me sort of explain we're the Permanent Fund we're trying to create permanent lasting change that will live on beyond our lifetime. We're using philanthropy as a change agent for this lasting change. So that's sort of our deadline and our mission. And one of the first things we said was we need to understand the population, the universe, the data before we can even set out to figure out our strategy and how we're going to get this done. So we did a real high-level census-based supply and demand analysis, mm-hmm. which I think is what you're referring to. And that's where we realized 7 out of 10 kids, just to create our sort of, you know, demand number, 7 out of 10 kids under 6 in Vermont have all available parents in the workforce. But half of those do not have access to regulated care, and only a third is considered quality. So I think some of these numbers, we just renewed this report. It's called the Stalled at the Start report. And we found that 51% of Vermont infants and toddlers that are likely to need care do not have access to any regulated program. And 77% of that group don't have access to high quality programming. And it, for infants, which are our babies, it's even worse. So 98% of infants likely to need care in some counties do not have access to childcare. So as you can sort of see, we do have a bit of a crisis on our hands with how much childcare is available, how much is, and how much is quality. And then for affordability, many, many families can't afford this. Some pay up to 40% of their gross household income on childcare, more than housing or other parts of their household budgets.
And you mentioned the word quality. Now, how is that ensured? Are there state regulations or
yes.
How do you get involved with that?
Great question. Quality, one way to talk about it is sort of what it actually looks like on the ground. It's a nurturing, consistent caregiver with a friendly and stimulating, bright environment, exposure to lots of vocabulary and different activities, outdoor play and an outdoor space, nutritious food. So there are sort of these elements of what does it actually look like to really get that high quality for this return on investment and these outcomes for these kids that we're looking for. And actually, you know, a part of it is really healthcare related, access to developmental screenings and then referrals into other services. So the ultimate sort of prevention and early intervention. So that's quality. And we have what's called our STAR system. It's a step ahead recognition system. And so that's what is called our quality rating system, but we actually call it a recognition system. And so it's voluntary, but you basically, as a program, you earn points in the quality system, and it's state regulated through the Agency of Human Services. And you have to meet certain requirements and minimum standards. And then there are also some federal requirements as well. And Head Start is a great example of a very high quality program that has, you know, even higher standards, that is for low-income 0 to 5-year-olds.
Tell us some of the projects your group's been involved in the past, and what are your current projects?
Great question. And so, for example, the pre-K work was one example of a type of project we would do. And the other one was we did peer-to-peer mentoring. So we created a cohort of very high-quality early childhood educators in the state of Vermont, and we paid them to go out and work with their peers in childcare programs and pre-K programs to improve their quality. And we went from 14%, just so quickly on the sort of background side, you know, early childhood education happens in a few different settings. It happens in homes, home-based childcare. It happens in centers, and it happens in public programs, pre-K classrooms. And so we did a mentoring program, and on the home-based providers, we realized we had a bit of a gap. They needed some support, didn't have access to a lot of mentoring or resources, and only 14% of home-based providers were even participating in the quality rating system. So we did our mentoring work and moved that to 78% of home-based childcare in the STAR system, and it's actually holding there. So we did another analysis last year and said, we're actually moving the needle on quality of current childcare. But when we look at these numbers, like you say, they're alarming. We do not have enough physical childcare. So it's great that the quality is going up, but it's not going to work for anyone if they can't access it. So we've actually pivoted to what's called Make Way for Kids. And it's a grant and technical assistance program, which actually we're going community by community, and we're increasing the number of high-quality childcare spaces for children. And our goal is actually to increase 500 new places for kids 0 to 5 this year alone. And you know what's really exciting, Dennis, is we just got our applications back from that. We weren't sure if there was a network of folks out there in Vermont who really wanted to open childcare, expand their childcare centers, their pre-Ks. And we had an overwhelming response of people from incredible backgrounds who said, I've always wanted to do this and I just needed a little support. So it's small startup grants, and it's a team that comes in and looks at your situation locally and in your program, helps you with a business model, helps connect dots to businesses, to healthcare, hospitals, higher ed institutions, and say, how can we actually make this work for us in this town? And I also want to mention if our mission is high quality, affordable, early care and learning, the way that we do that in the permanent fund is through Let's Grow Kids, which is a public awareness, public will campaign. It's really a movement, building a movement. And then there's Vermont Birth to Five. So those are our sort of signature projects. And if you want to think about it, you know, Let's Grow Kids is this, you know, high level strategy of changing the way we do business in the state of Vermont, getting Vermonters to be a part of this movement, to understand the importance of childcare in their lives. And then on the other side, Vermont Birth to Five, and they work very closely together, is actually doing program work in the state. So technical assistance, professional development, grants to improve the quality of childcare, the accessibility of childcare, and also streamline the system to make sure that it is as efficient as possible.
Those two programs look very successful. Could you give us some examples of how those programs have changed things for people you've been working with?
Absolutely, actually. And thank you for that question. So Let's Grow Kids is a little different. It's sort of, you know, how do you measure something before you've reached your success of changing state policy to add public investment, and create sort of a different policy context for this situation. So we've had to sort of, I always say, how do you digest the elephant? How do you break it into these chunks? Because that's a pretty big mission that we're after.
The whole thing is a big mission.
It's pretty big, that's right. It's a large enterprise. And Let's Grow Kids, we've had to say, well, how are we, as you say, changing the hearts and minds and making progress? One example is the media. You know, when we first started, no one was really talking about early child education, pre-K, childcare. And now we get about 5 to 10 stories in the press a week. You know, it changes week to week, but we have on average, you know, every week that goes by, we have some stories on the brain development, on the shortage of childcare programs, on various sort of things that are moving through the legislature that affect this issue. So it's all of a sudden elevated into people's consciousness. And, you know, Vermont Edition had a great episode a couple weeks ago about getting young people to move to the state of Vermont. Mm-hmm. And childcare dominated that issue with callers and others who said, well, wait a minute, why aren't we talking about childcare? You know, no other state has this right. Could you just imagine the effect high quality, affordable childcare as a policy would have on getting young families and businesses to move to Vermont? We really have a chance to corner the market on this, and it will really help our demographic challenges that we're facing as a state. So that's one piece of Let's Grow Kids. Another one is, the funding into the system. 2 years ago, we started working with our sort of advocacy apparatus, and we helped work with partners to get $1 million increase annually into the system, which is just really a small step. It's significant funding, but for high quality, affordable childcare, you know, sort of a very first step. Then we saw it elevated to a gubernatorial issue. Another great example of how we're changing sort of the needle. Both Sue Minter and Phil Scott, when they were running for governor, made this one of their key issues in their campaigns and really elevated it. And then when Governor Scott was elected, he made this the largest increase of any area in his first budget address. He proposed $9.6 million increased into childcare, and we ended up working together to get 2.5, which is still a big step up in a very tough, you know, budget year. Mm-hmm. Right here in Burlington, Mayor Weinberger has also really taken on this issue and understands the economic development, the workforce development implications of it. And he has reallocated $500,000 to create high quality, affordable slots for low income families in Burlington alone annually. So you're starting to see things pop up. We're seeing businesses step up and really, you know, say, how can I be a part of this problem? We thought we might have a little bit of a pitch to make with businesses, mm-hmm. to see how important is this to your bottom line, to your workforce, and we didn't. We started working with businesses, and they said, "You got us. We see every single day how the lack of affordable and accessible childcare is really affecting the absenteeism, mm-hmm. and the recruitment and retention of our employees, mm-hmm. and not to mention their sort of productivity throughout the day." So we have these wonderful businesses all across Vermont in all different sectors and all different sizes stepping up to say, how can we be a part of this solution here?
Well, I notice there's a word there. It's a very interesting website, collaborative philanthropy. Mm-hmm. Tell us what that's about.
So that's, I would say, one of our key strengths about sort of the culture of the Permanent Fund and who we are. So we happen to be sort of the on-the-ground operator, but we would not be here today without other family foundations, individuals. There's two things about our name that are a little misleading. Mm-hmm. One is the word permanent, and the other one is fund, because we're actually not endowed. We fundraise annually for our work. And
just your expenses.
Yes, for our expenses. That's right, for Let's Grow Kids, and Vermont Birth to Five, the staffing and the grant making. And we really work very closely with other funders. So again, individuals and mostly family foundations, all with ties to Vermont. And the Turrell Fund and the A.D. Henderson Foundation are two funders who, again, have been in this space for a long time, decades, and have really sort of worked to help us leverage funding and make a much bigger difference. When we sort of came together and pooled resources and pooled sort of our brains and our experiences in the field and in this work, you could really see it was sort of a catalytic event that shot us to the next level, creating Vermont Birth to Five, Let's Grow Kids, and really putting us on a path to actually be able to move on this really ambitious but achievable goal in the time frame that we've set out for.
That's amazing. Now, what are the issues, we're now almost in the middle of the legislative session, and what are the issues you're pushing today?
Another great question. So, okay, this is the... Again, how to digest the elephant. Public investment is needed because currently, how do we pay for, you know, today, high quality early childhood education? There's some federal money, very little federal money that comes in. There's some state funding, and through pre-K, which is more significant now, and childcare financial assistance, and then parents pay, in many cases, much more than they can afford, and then the rest of it is sort of on the backs of those who provide it. In other words, child care providers don't take a livable wage. And in some cases, you know, the average, I believe, is $26,000 as an annual salary for child care providers. So, and they know they can't charge parents anymore because they're already charging them too much. In many cases, child care providers don't take salaries or benefits because they're trying to balance their budget and not charge parents more. So something's got to give in this business model. And that's, you know, some public investment is certainly going to make a difference here. So currently there is a bill there's a work in the legislature through the budget to increase $9.6 million for child care financial assistance. And that is just to keep up with inflation. So we are $9.6 million behind in inflation for our current funding mechanism. That's childcare financial assistance. So that is a first step. If you were able to make an investment like that today, it's the first big step in the right direction to creating the system. And then it allows the field to adjust because there are a lot of market factors here. Mm-hmm. So it allows them to sort of hire up start improving their quality and starting to get parents to be able to afford their services.
That's great. We have a wonderful website and there's a great deal of information on that. And I'm sure that you're available for people
Absolutely.
To contact you. And just maybe tell our guests in the studio audience and abroad what you like as a parting message.
Well, I guess I would say, we are trying, as I said earlier, we are trying to change the way that we do business as a state of Vermont. So we need Vermonters to be a part of this movement. You can sign our petition, letsgrowkids.org. You can talk to your legislators. You can be a part of figuring out the solution to this thorny problem and then moving it forward. If you're a business, you can work with us to see how you can support your own childcare needs for your employees. And I would just say the most important thing is be a part of the solution. Join the campaign. And you know, if you're an early childhood educator or provider, you can be in touch with us with our grant making program. But really, we need to say as a state of Vermont that we're going to get this done, and it's going to be a really collective effort.
That's great. Well, thank you very much. My special guest today has been Aly Richards. Thank you, Aly, CEO of the Permanent Fund for Vermont's Children. And this is Dennis McMahon for Positively Vermont.